lecture on the history of yoga. This is also quite a new lecture because here I just wanted to put an overview of the different aspects of yoga and the different traditions of yoga and where they have been put into a timeline so you can understand a little bit more. Now, it can be quite confusing. Where did this Karma Yoga come from? Where did this Bhakti Yoga come from? What is this Ashtanga Yoga? What is this Hatha Yoga? And then understanding where along the timeline all of these are. Okay. So this is just a brief history of yoga from ancient times to present. So we have the start, pre-classical yoga. So from 10,000 BC up to 500 BC. So this is where yoga was around. Of course, it was not written down as such. It was just from the teacher to the student, guru to disciple. In that way, it was guru to disciple in the traditional way of times. And so it's hard to know exactly when it started. Okay. Here, we have the Vedas, which is the first written copies where some of the knowledge of yoga was put. And again, one's not really sure. We write around 5,000 years, but of course orally 10,000 years, possibly longer than that. We don't really have any idea about how long yoga has been around. Here we've got the Vedas, which is a collection of lots of different knowledge, which was around in India at that time. Now these days what happens, someone has some kind of knowledge and they share that and say, this is my view, this is my way of thinking. Whereas with the Vedas, it was lots of different contributions from many different people. So it was a lot of knowledge to help society. So some poetry is there, some discussion about ritual is there, some ways of living is there, some types of thinking is there. Everything is put together without anyone saying, this is my thoughts, this is my way of doing it. It's just some things that can be helpful. You've got a little bit of discussion about God as a form of energy. So that's the beginnings of the yoga that we talk about. Also the natural energy sources, things like the energy of fire, the energy of water, sun, air, so on. And the discussion about intelligent energy. So all of these things are talked about in the Vedas. And then after that, we have the Upanishads, which is where a little bit more specific discussion on yoga is there. You've got the discussion about pratyaha, withdrawal of the senses. Okay. You're doing that in yoga nidra. So one of the limbs of Ashtanga Yoga, Patanjali is Ashtanga Yoga. So it started here. You've got a controlling of the mind, okay, which is one of the main focuses of practicing of yoga, is to be able to control the mind. Okay. And then you've also got the discussion about enlightenment, samadhi, nirvana, whatever you like to call it, getting to that blissful state. Okay. Some discussion is also there about asana and pranayama, meditation. Then we have the different remains, archaeological remains. Here, dating back to 5000 BC. But of course, there's not a lot of remains to show what was happening at that time. You'll see it in your books as well, probably the picture is there. There's a few different things. Now, two of these places are where these have been found. Harappa up the top and Mohenjo-daro further down. This is in what's now known as Pakistan, but of course before it was India. Okay. So in these two areas these things were found. There's also other archaeological remains that have been discussed in other countries. Now some people say, oh, but yoga is from India. But then other people say, no, yoga was not from India. Yoga was everywhere. It's only that it stayed in India, it got preserved, and of course a lot of it was lost. So much knowledge has been lost in India because of the various invasions that have occurred, but still something stayed. whereas in other cultures, it's been lost. So much discussion, especially in places like Central America, South America, the discussion on the Mayans having a lot of this knowledge of yoga. Probably most civilizations, this knowledge was there of how to connect ourselves, how to connect our mind and body, how to connect with that higher energy was around. People were a little more in tune with themselves and with nature than they are these days. But, you know, with different invasions that occur, things get lost, unfortunately. So here you can see these pictures. Now you look on the left side, looks very Egyptian to me. It's apparently here, but to me, it makes you think, were they doing yoga in Egypt? Of course, asana is one aspect. Of course, there's so much more. You all know that. And here you can see the different positions. Here you can see the meditative asanas that they were sitting in. Vajrasana, some know it as butterfly pose, Tiddlyasana, Baddhakonasana. Then we have these different seated positions in Harappa. So different meditative asanas again. Also some prayer, some hands in prayer position, namaskar position. So, you know, praying to possibly, or they believe to some kind of energies or gods, whatever it may be for them. Okay. Also, I've heard about some different sculptures of yoga practices in places like Bolivia, but very difficult to find any more information. Mm-hmm. If you find anything, let me know. Mm-hmm. It's around. One minute. Okay. Hi, y'all. So let's continue. So discussion about Ramayana. Who's read the Ramayana? Anyone?
Not read it, but I know. I mean,
yeah, you're Indian.
I used to watch it on TV.
Yeah. Yeah. No, no one else read. Okay. Yeah, I asked you. Yeah, if you're from India, you have to know. It's one of the most famous stories that is there. Whether you read it, or okay, someone told you the story, or you watched the cartoon, or watched something else, it's going to be there. So it's a very common story in India. Of course, it's many people just think children's story. That's what they think. But then it has a lot of good values in it as well for how we should be living. Okay, how to find our purpose in life. How to follow our Dharma. All of this is discussed there in the Ramayana. So it's not just a story for children to read. It's also a story for adults to learn more about. And many times not appreciated because they just think, oh yeah, okay. It's the story of Rama and Sita. So Rama and Sita, married couple, then Sita gets abducted, taken to Lanka, Sri Lanka these days, and then rescued, okay. So it's also looked at as Rama and Sita are the perfect couple. So people look at them as, okay, this is how you can have a positive relationship where you can also grow with each other, that you can stay balanced, that you can follow a positive life. Okay. So we have the Ramayana, and then we have the Mahabharata. Now, everyone in India knows this again because of the massive show, the massive television serial that went on for more than 100 episodes. It's really very long. You can watch it these days online, or you can get like box DVD sets of it. It's very long, it's very interesting, very funny too. But of course, the Mahabharata is a very large story, and inside that is the Bhagavad Gita, which is especially one of the core texts of yoga, particularly of Karma Yoga. So here again, many people look at the Mahabharata and they think children's story. But then again, it has so many deeper aspects to it that one can learn from at any age. Okay. It does discuss the four goals of one's life. And the most important for us is about the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita is known as Indian Yoga Psychology, you can say. The psychology course, they're going to have a lot of discussions on Bhagavad Gita. Who has read Bhagavad Gita?
Somewhat.
Yeah. Somewhat, a little bit, okay. Now, a lot of people read it, but then how many people actually understand it? That's another story. If you understand it completely, then you're enlightened. Because to understand all of Bhagavad Gita is very difficult.
Some parts.
Some parts. We have to understand some parts, but we can't understand everything. Because if we understand everything, we can apply everything, we will never have a problem in our life. We'll never face any problem. One of Ganda's teachers, he's over 90 years old now. And he has his PhD in Bhagavad Gita. He's written many books on Bhagavad Gita in Marathi and Hindi. And he said to Ganda, we need to write it in English. Okay? So we need to have a translation, because the English translations of Bhagavad Gita are not all very good. Okay? It's just how it is. So we started to write one, him, me and Ganda and Bao, this teacher of his. And still many new things he was learning. We of course were learning, because if we think we learn everything, we have a long way to go. But he was still learning so many things. Now, he'd been studying Bhagavad Gita since he was a little boy, you know. So, more than 80 years of study of Bhagavad Gita, and still many more things he was learning. So, there's so much knowledge packed into the Bhagavad Gita that we can never say that we understand everything that is there. Okay? And also, everyone has their different views of Bhagavad Gita. So, that's why we read different translations, we get different understandings of it. It's very, very concise. Just like other yogic texts, they're very, very concise. So there can be many different meanings and understandings from that. Okay. So here you can say some of the greatest knowledge that has come out of India has been the Bhagavad Gita. We know it when Modi became Prime Minister, what was his first gift? Bhagavad Gita to the Japanese Prime Minister. Yes, and probably he gives it to all of them now. Please read a little bit of this. But lots of people have read it, but to really have that deep understanding is quite difficult. Okay. So basically, just an overview of Bhagavad Gita is that they're on the battlefield. There's Arjuna, he's the head of the Pandavas. We've got Krishna, and Arjuna has to fight his family members, and he goes into this state of depression, this state of despondency. What can I do? How can I fight my family? How can I kill my family? This is not the right thing to do in one's life. Okay, and so he has to have discussion with Krishna. What am I going to do about it? And then Krishna guides him, and he starts teaching him all sorts of knowledge of yoga to help him understand. Now, when we think of real life, many times we have to go down before we can come up. No. We can't understand things, we can't appreciate things until we go like down into some state. Maybe depression, maybe just a little bit low, something bad happens, whatever. And then we can start to understand our life a little bit more. So he went into this state of depression before he could understand his meaning and purpose and duty in life. So you've got lots of different yoga discussed here. You've got karma yoga, the yoga of action, okay, action without expectation of fruits. Then you've got bhakti yoga, you've got jnana yoga, yoga of knowledge. You'll have some more discussion about this after. So all these different styles of yoga, traditions of yoga, were taught by Krishna to Arjuna. So it's very interesting to have a read of Bhagavad Gita, and it's not something you just read front to back, because then it's very superficial. You have to read a little bit, think about it, try to apply it, then read a bit more. And if you have many different translations, then you can also compare how they are, because one person says this, one person says that. One person says this word in Sanskrit means this, another person says no, it means this. There's so much controversy like that. So it's good to read many and then get your own ideas about it. And then applying it also. Now in India, many people chant Bhagavad Gita. Okay. But they don't actually apply it to their life at all. Many times. So we want to actually use it. Otherwise, what's the point? Okay. So seeing how we can actively apply into our life to make our life better is what we want. So after Bhagavad Gita, we have Patanjali, so the classical era of yoga. So around 500 BC. So Patanjali, you've had a little bit already some discussions and some lectures from Guruji about Ashtanga yoga. So many people here get confused. What is Ashtanga yoga, Ashtanga Vinyasa yoga, and so on. So there's Ashtanga yoga. It's also called Raja yoga by many. Okay, different names are there for this style of yoga, which is based on, of course, the classical text of the Yoga Sutras by Patanjali. Not everyone, we don't know exactly who is Patanjali. It might be even the same person as Buddha. There's some controversy about that. They don't really know. Some of the principles are very similar to Buddhism that are there. Did Lokesh teach you this prayer at the beginning that you're doing before class, this Yogena Chittasya? Have you started chanting?
Yes.
Yeah? So this is a prayer to Patanjali, basically thanking Patanjali for his knowledge. And here we're thanking him for purifying the language through the use of Sanskrit, because of course he was a scholar in Sanskrit, for purification of the body through Ayurveda, and the mind through yoga. See here, we're looking at the yoga and mind, not yoga and body. So the higher purpose of yoga is with mind. Okay. So giving thanks to Patanjali for that knowledge that he's brought. Okay. So again, the sutras, there's a lot of controversy about what the things mean, because again, it's so concise that there's lot of chance that people can read it in a different way, understand it in a different way. So again, it's good to have comparisons. There's a very good book on Yoga Sutras. It's in the library and it's in the shop. 4 Chapters on Freedom by Swami Satyananda. Very easy to understand. Of course, you're not just going to read from beginning to end. You're again going to read one sutra, read the discussion about it, the commentary about it, think about, let it sit in your mind for some time, then read the next one. Okay? It's not something that you can just gain straight away. So here is where the real Ashtanga yoga started. Now, of course, when people say Ashtanga yoga, they think Ashtanga vinyasa. But of course, Ashtanga yoga is only got the real Ashtanga yoga, only has 3 sutras for asana. So only a small aspect is asana, whereas Ashtanga Vinyasa is pretty much mostly asana. Okay, there's some other aspects, we'll talk about that a little bit later. But Ashtanga Yoga, or Raja Yoga as it's called, is Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga. So then we have this post-classical yoga. So this is the era of Hatha Yoga, Tantra. Okay, this is where it all came about. Tantra came a little bit earlier, so tantric practices were going on, and then the Hatha yogis came on. Buddhism was very popular at the time. Everyone was meditating, you know, everyone was doing their little ritualistic things. And the Hatha yogis came in and said, well, you can't all just meditate. And look at you, you're getting fat because you're just meditating. You're not doing anything else. Your bodies are becoming difficult to deal with. So you need to look at a holistic view. Okay. So here, the Hatha yogis were specifically about purification of the body, and then leading to the deeper states of meditation. Okay. Here, around 600 AD was when a lot of the Hatha yogis came about. There's many different texts on Hatha yoga. Hatha Yoga Pradipika is the main one that maybe some of you have heard about. If you want to read more about it, the Hatha Yoga Pradipika is in the library. It's also in the shop. It's much easier to understand than the Yoga Sutras or Bhagavad Gita, because it's just how it is. it's like a manual. It's like a Hatha Yoga manual. Okay, there's not a lot of philosophy in there, so you can't really change it about so much. It's just like, okay, this is how you do this, this is how you do this. You've got your asanas, you've got your pranayam, you've got your mudras, you've got a few strange things in there too, so be prepared if you do open it. Some strange things are related to so many aspects, but you just have a read and you'll understand. So it's a very interesting book to have a read of as well, if you are interested in what the ancient yogis talked about. Okay. But so is the Yoga Sutras. There's many interesting discussions about, you know, the siddhis, the different perfections that one could achieve through the practices of yoga. Very interesting. Okay. So some of the other books that are there, Shiva Samhita, Goraksha Samhita, all of these are there. You've got a few specific people that were at the forefront of Hatha Yoga. You've got this Matsyendranath and his disciple Gorakshanath. Ardha Matsyendrasana, you know this pose, right? So it's the half spinal twist. It's taken after this said Matsyendranath, who was from the Natha tradition. And his favorite position was the spinal twist, but the full one. You're only doing the half one. Ganda will show you the full one. It's not easy, I'll tell you that. And that's why everyone does the half one. Instead of having the foot around the side of the hip, the foot is inside. So it's like a half lotus position, Ardha Padmasana, the foot inside, and then twisting. So very advanced position. But that was his favorite pose. So that's what he meditated in. There's also a position for the other disciple too. You can see, some of you might be able to see this picture here. This is like the idea of the Hatha Yogi, many times naked, you know, covered in ash for keeping himself at a regular temperature. Here, doing headstand, lotus in headstand. Okay. Though many times very strong. They could deal with so many different things, changes in temperature and situations and different body positions and purification and all of that. Then we move on to Adi Shankaracharya. So he is, a big saint in India. He's respected a lot. One of the main reasons is that he kind of brought India together, because people were practicing many different things, and then there was a lot of conflict between them, saying, no, we're doing this way, no, we're doing this way, no, this is the right way, this is the wrong way, blah, 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 blah. So he said, actually, you're all doing the good things. They're all similar. You don't need to, you know, argue about it. They're all going in the same direction. When we're practicing yoga, there's many different paths that we can take, but ultimately the direction is the same. So he reminded them of that, or taught them that, so that they didn't need to be intolerant of each other, and they could accept that, okay, you can do it like this, I will do it like this, that's fine. Okay. Then some of the important aspects that he brought out, which have become very popular now, I would say. You see all these new age books, self-help books, they have a lot of his techniques here. You are not your thoughts, you're the awareness behind the thoughts. Very popular now. Only the present moment exists, accepting that. This whole concept of be here now. Okay, this is very popular. Being a witness to the pain and the mind. So always taking that step back and observing what's going on. Okay. And my favorite, everything has the spark of divine. Everyone has that divinity inside them. Not every person, everything. Animals, trees, everything is having that energy within it. So this is very helpful to bring people together and to get rid of intolerance. There was a big gap from when Adi Shankaracharya was around, because there was a lot of invasions. And because of those invasions, a lot of the yogis, they hid, they fled. Mostly to the mountains, because less invasions were occurring in those areas. It was difficult for them to get to invade those spaces. So they fled up there to keep that knowledge. Of course, a lot of it was lost at those times, but then some of it has been kept. So in the modern times, so from the 1890s to now, we have these different yogis that came around. Some you'll recognize, still very popular. So we've got first Swami Vivekananda. Okay, he is in the middle. Okay, so he went to Chicago, he went to America, and he spoke to those people in America and really started to change their view on the practices of yoga and the culture in India, especially. You can see the picture that is there. Okay, he talked about many different aspects, a lot of philosophy, and you can even read his speech on the internet. You can find that whole written speech there if you have that interest. His guru was Ramakrishna, the one on the left. He was had a very, very simple life, lived in the Kali temple in Kolkata these days. There. Very simple, but very powerful. Simple life. Then we have Paramahansa Yogananda. Many of you will recognize at least this picture because his book is very famous, Autobiography of a Yogi. Who's read it? Some of you, yes. It's a very nice book to read. You can get it everywhere in India and everywhere now you can get it. It's very cheap also. In the library it's also there. Basically, he went around India and he wanted to find the real yogis and he wanted to know what they were practicing and what special things had occurred to them because of what they were doing. So it's very interesting, all the different people that he met, and very difficult to find these people. You know? They're not out there saying, yeah, yeah, I can do this, I can do that. It's not like that, not the real yogis. So he found some of them. Of course, this is a bit longer back before yoga became really popular and there's like a guru on every corner, like there is now. But it's very interesting to read about his experience there. And he is very much about Kriya Yoga. He taught a lot of Kriya Yoga. And he went to America. He shared a lot of his knowledge in America. We can also put a small film on. Has anyone seen it? Called Awake? It's a documentary of Yogananda. It's very interesting. Last month I put it on for everybody about his experience of bringing yoga to the West and also how he was treated. He went through difficult times, as many did when they left India. Even in India, of course, also difficult times. So, and of course, his form of yoga is still going strong around the world. Then we've got Swami Kavalyananda. So he started Kavalyadham. Some of you would have heard of Kavalyadham. There's an institute in Lonavala, a few hours away from here. So he was very much interested in yoga therapy. Yoga therapy is very new. Okay? It's not something ancient. It's only been the last 100 years or so that it's come into existence. Because before, not everyone practiced yoga. And if people had different types of problems, they wouldn't necessarily go and do yoga. A lot of the people that practiced were the ones that had renounced everything in their life and they just went and did that. Okay. So he was very interested in yoga therapy and he was very interested in the scientific research related with yoga. Okay. So he did a lot of that. Guruji has a lot of influence from Swami Kavalyananda because of this. And even the structure of our course has, you know, a little bit more on the cleansing and the way that we're practicing is a little bit more based on that style. He has had a journal, Yoga Mimamsa. So you can see some of those down in the library. You might be able to look at them online now. I'm not 100% sure, but about the different research that they did. They're still conducting some research, but it's not as much because now he's passed, so some therapy is going on there. They don't have an ashram as such, it's more of a therapy research center, and especially focusing on things like cleansing and pranayama, they're very big for them. Then we have the 20s and 30s, so Hatha Yoga became more popular again. And you've got a few different teachers that became very popular, particularly outside India. In India, there were many different teachers. You cannot say that there was just one that was like taking over. Many small teachers were there. But outside India, some of these teachers became a little bit more popular. I would say more popular outside India than inside India. Yeah, really. So we have one of the main teachers of these three, he's actually their teacher, is Krishnamacharya. Okay. So he was from South India. Now you asked Ganda 10 years ago, who is Krishnamacharya? No idea. Not popular within India, but very popular outside India. Now, these are his three disciples, and all three of them started practicing yoga in very different ways. Okay. The first one, who knows the top on the right? Iyengar. Yes. Iyengar yoga. Iyengar. He started Iyengar yoga. He doesn't call it that, but that's what his disciples call it. So he became very popular. Of course, we were discussing the other day, his style is very popular for maintaining positions for longer periods of time and very, very specific alignment and many times use of props. So that became popular with his style. And it also became popular, his way of teaching, because of the influences that he had on his life. He did not have an easy time. Of course, he came to yoga when he was younger, and he had major problems with his breathing. So he needed treatment, yoga therapy basically, to heal him of that. And once he was healed and good, which he learned from this Krishnamacharya, he went to Europe. He was not treated nicely. You know, at those times, racism was very, very big. Here's this Indian man going to Europe, people look down on him. You know, he's brown skin, he's vegetarian. Mm-hmm. Who's vegetarian? That's crazy. You know, people thought in that way. And they would be, you know, smoking the cigarettes, blowing the cigarette smoke in his face. Even when he came here, he gave us this story. Many times he's given this story. It's still inside him, what it was, till he passed. And so he thought to himself, well, I'm going to show them. You know, I can do all these things that you cannot do. So his style of teaching became very rigid and very particular. And it was all just because of that influence of how he was treated in his life. Now you'll see these other two, they taught in different ways. This one at the bottom, Desikacha, he started this Vini yoga. Quite therapeutic, more one-on-one style of yoga. Not as popular as these other two, but still popular. Then we've got Pattabhi Joyce. Now he was also very popular. He is popular, but he's also passed. Starting of Ashtanga Vinyasa. Now Ashtanga Vinyasa is one of the very popular styles outside India. Now it's starting to decrease a bit. Now this yin yoga is becoming more popular. But that's what happens with styles of yoga. If you just attach yourself to a style, it will be popular for some time and it will go down. So that's why I always say to you guys, don't just get with a style. Just teach your own way. That's better. So he started with this Ashtanga Vinyasa, lots of flowing yoga with Ujjayi breathing, very set series. So all three of them taught in very different ways. Now this Krishnamacharya, he also did some flowing yoga. It was not traditional. It's not traditional. You know that. It's not a traditional way of practicing. But what was happening was he was teaching some Maharaja down in his area. And the Maharaja asked him to teach to the kids. So the kids could not go and hold an asana for this long and then do this other one and hold it and be steady. So he did some flowing things with them and they liked it. And then people picked up on that and they enjoyed this flowing. Especially, you know, younger people that can't keep their mind focused always. Not generalizing, but for some they find it more difficult. So the flowing aspect was very attractive. And then you think of people that are trying to make themselves fit and lose weight. So again, that whole package became very popular. So all three different ways of practicing yoga were there. So don't get confused with Ashtanga and Ashtanga Vinyasa. Now, if you look deeply at the Ashtanga Vinyasa, the primary series is very popular, but of course the more advanced series are much more difficult. to do. And the advanced series are not just flowing here, there, you know, every 5 breaths or so. It's actually maintaining. So he wanted to teach those other aspects of Ashtanga Yoga, you know, the steadiness and leading up to meditation. But it was not very popular, and he did it in such a rigorous way that it was very difficult for them to get to that stage where he would actually start teaching them pranayama. So the regular student was not exposed to doing pranayama and meditation. It was all the asana and the strenuous asanas, this faster movements that they were exposed to. And probably that's because that's what they were interested in. It wasn't that he just wanted to teach that, but sometimes it's what the students are wanting to do all the time, and it just becomes that way. Okay. Like this Iyengar Yoga, when Iyengar came here, some student asked him, what is Iyengar Yoga? He says, there's no such thing as Iyengar Yoga. Why are people calling the Iyengar Yoga, yoga is yoga, that's it. But we know that people like to brand things. So it became a style. So this is some of the teachers that did become very popular outside. But as I've said, in India, some people knew, some didn't. Like Gandhi, he was raised in Pune. So he knew Iyengar because he went. His mother went to school with Gita Iyengar, his daughter. So they knew each other. But then not very well known around. Now he's quite popular, but probably because he became popular in West, so he becomes popular in India. It's kind of how it goes. We've got Swami Sivananda. He founded the Divine Life Society, okay, which is still going strong in Rishikesh, amongst the teacher training on every corner. The Divine Life Society is still there teaching the same things that they were teaching from the beginning. Here, when he went to Rishikesh, there were not many people there. There were a lot of yogis there, but many of them were not very healthy. There wasn't a lot of food. They weren't getting very good nutrition. There was also a lot of things like mosquitoes, so there was a lot of disease that was there. And he was a doctor, so he started to heal them, like you can see in the picture there. And he had many different disciples, and they again went in different directions. Their styles still remained quite similar to his, but they went out in their different ways. So we've got Swami Chidananda and Krishnananda. They continued with the Divine Life Society. And if you're interested in the books of Divine Life Society, you can go onto their website. From any country, you can buy them online, and they'll send them to you. And they're very cheap. There's no like different price. It still remains the Indian price to order any of their books. Very cheap, the books are. Like, they try to make them as cheap as possible so maximum people can be exposed to them. And you can go there also. They have some courses there. They're, of course, very strict ashram. Okay. Not so easy. Not as easy as here. Then we have Swami Satyananda, who started the Bihar School of Yoga. Okay. Swami Sachidananda, he started Integral Yoga. I think it's quite popular in Canada. Again, it's still traditional yoga. Many different aspects are being taught. And then Swami Vishnu Devananda, he became popular with the Shivananda Yoga teacher trainings. Okay. Maybe you thought about going to one of them before you came here. I think the headquarters is in the Bahamas. but there's many different centers around. There's many in India. There's many countries there. And they again teach a quite traditional style of yoga. So we've got the Swami Satyananda, who, as I mentioned, we might have to stop in a second. So talking on Swami Satyananda, so he was living with Swami Sivananda for 12 years, and then Swami Sivananda said to him, okay, you've had enough time here, now you have to go out, and you have to go and start spreading yoga. So he told him, you had to spread yoga from door to door and shore to shore. Big job. So pretty much that was his duty from then on, that he had to follow in his life, was to spread yoga in this way. And he's done it in such a massive way. We know because of Swami Satyananda, yoga has gone all over the world. He started the Bihar School of Yoga. He also started the International Yoga Fellowship Movement, the Yoga Research Foundation, and there are many different ashrams and centers around the world that are spreading traditional yogic knowledge. You will see the Bihar School of Yoga, they have maximum books that they've published related to different aspects of yoga, okay? More than any other place. So Swami Satyananda continued with that. You can see his picture there on the bottom. Swami Shivananda is the big one, and then the disciple Swami Satyananda. And he has also left his body now, which was also very interesting. Because he said to his disciples, one of them was Swami Naranjan, and he said to his closest disciples, Swami Naranjan and Swami Satsangi, one of the female Swamis, he said, okay, I'm leaving now. I decided now's my time. And he said, you can't stop me now. But previously he was ready to leave, and they were like, no, you have to stay. They said, now you can't stop me. And so he went into his place, he sat in Padmasana, he started his Guru Mantra, and he left his body at midnight, exactly. So he attained Samadhi, but permanent Samadhi, no coming back. And after that, they looked after his body, and his body was buried in Padmasana, still in Padmasana. Very interesting life that he led. So Swami Naranjan was his successor. He was the head of the Bihar School of Yoga for a long time. Now it's moved on to other Swamis, but he was there. Many of the books from the Bihar School of Yoga are from Swami Naranjan. He's still in charge of one of the schools, the Sannyas Darshan. Now there's for Bihar School of Yoga, there's a few different places. One is Munger, which is the main place where a lot of the study is done for yoga. Then there's Rikya, which is more of an ashram related to Seva, Karma Yoga, which one does all day long. And then there's Sannyas Darshan, which is for people that want to really renounce their life and follow one of yoga. And he has been in the ashram since he was 4 years old. not exactly since he was four, but he wanted to be there since the age of four. So he started going there, and he wanted to live there permanently. Actually, since he was, you know, moving, he wanted to be there. And then he started to live there, and he started to lecture at the age of 11, traveling around the world and lecturing. Now you think of the regular 11-year-old. Like, what 11-year-old can give lectures to adults on yoga philosophy? You know, it's very difficult. Even we had one student here who was at one of his lectures when he was a teenager and still remembers how amazed everyone was, and the words that he spoke at such a young age could impact people on such a deep level. So he's been spreading yoga in this way. He's still doing many satsangs. He's not traveling around countries these days. Mostly he's doing a lot of deeper yogic practices. So this is the end of our tour of yoga from what we think are the beginnings to the present day. There's been many different influences that have been there on yoga. Of course, I'm not going to get into all the styles of yoga that are popular at the present moment. I'm only talking about the traditional types of yoga that are there. But hopefully it can help you to start to understand where things originated from. Remembering that there are so many different paths that will take us to that same goal. So we'll finish there. Hari Om.